Hello everyone.
A good day to you. This is Dr. Rachita Mishra speaking to you. So today in our software engineering course, we will consider the class-based modeling techniques. The topics that we will go over in this lesson are the class modeling context, when we will use it, identifying the analysis classes, what is the methods to identify these classes at the analysis phase, then how to specify the attributes and define the operations. Then we will go into the CRC modeling, and then we will look into the class diagrams and class relations. So in the last class, we have seen that there are two major approaches to analysis. The first one is called as the structured analysis. The other one is called the object-oriented analysis. In structured analysis, we define the data objects and their attributes and relationship, as well as also we also try to express the functions in terms of the processes and that manipulate the data objects as defined earlier, and we try to create models for them. In the object-oriented analysis, we try to define the classes. We try to define the objects, and we try to generalize it into classes. Then we determine the relation, their collaboration between different classes, all to satisfy the user's function. So the classes are will hide the data into it, so we don't have to do the data separately. And we have seen that we are using the UML. So what is structured versus object-oriented? Now, actually, if you also include the design methodologies along with the analysis, then together we can term it as structured system analysis and design, or in short, SSAD. And similarly, object-oriented analysis and design, known as OOAD. So if you see these two types of approaches, in the design phase also, that means in the complete analysis and design phase, SSAD, the process and data are separately modeled. First, they are modeled in analysis, and then the design phase modeling starts for the process and other things. And in OOAD, the objects are carrying the data within it. So only objects, classes, and the relation, and a lot of behavioral modeling is done. So there is a distinction between these two. And OOAD is now the preferred approach because OOAD provides a lot of opportunity for reuse of code. So once the code is reused, the time can be reduced. And also tested code is used, so its quality will be higher. As objects can be mapped to real life objects or entities, so it will be easy to understand for both users and development team. And agile processes or automated tools provide good support to OO approach. And the UML standard can be followed, which will ensure that there is a proper communication standard way of depicting things. And that will also ensure us quality. So what we have seen is that these are some of the different elements of the analysis model, four types, and each one has got many diagrams into it. So today we will be looking into the class-based diagrams. In last class, we have seen the flow-oriented elements. So in this lesson, we will consider this class-based elements, which are part of the SSAD, object-oriented analysis and design. Now, how to identify the analysis classes? At the time of analysis, if you remember, the input is the elicitation or the elicited requirements. So what is coming into the analysis, what is the input to the analysis, is the output of the elicitation, requirement elicitation phase, which is nothing but a set of well-defined requirements, which has been agreed upon with the customer. So from that point, by taking that input, we have to analyze and identify the classes. So the first thing, you have to identify the classes. So there are two approaches to do that. The first one is performing a grammatical phase. It is also called as a noun verb method. So what is done here? We identify the classes by examining the problem statement. So we actually read the problem statement, or rather we read the requirements also. We go through it, and from by doing the grammatical parsing of the sentences that are written, we try to identify the so either we can have a problem statement, or we can have a use case description, or we can have narratives regarding the process. So these are all developed during the elicitation phase. And by performing a grammatical analysis on it, we can identify the objects and the classes. And normally the nouns and verb clauses are selected as the potential class. So initially what we do, we determine, we take all the nouns and the verb, and we try to put it, we list it out as potential classes. And in the using the class responsibility and the collaboration cards also, we can do it. This is also in short called as a CRC method. Here it is a structured team collaborative effort to identify domain related classes. So mostly we determine the domain related classes here, and their attributes and their collaboration. Later on we will see how the other two types of classes can be determined. So how does this analysis classes manifest? When we see the statement and we try to do the grammatical parsing, then we need to understand what are the how does the classes manifest, what things we are supposed to look to for potential classes. So the first one is the external entities, which is nothing but the people, the device, other systems that will interact with the system. We have seen in the last lesson, we have seen the context diagram, which is the level 0 DFD. In that, we show all the external elements or external entities that will interact with the system. So these kind of external entities are their names or their types that is written in the statement are one potential, are can be identified as potential classes. Then there are things which are objects like reports, display, signals, or anything for that matter, that are part of the information domain for the problem. So those kind of things come across when we read the problem statement or the requirement specification. When we come across such kind of words, we can consider it as potential and analysis classes. And similarly, events, the occurrences or events within the context of the system while it is in use that affect its behavior or information content. So whenever there is an event that will occur, what will happen? The process may change, it may transition, and or rather the state will change. It will transition to a different state. And what will happen? Its behavior, the system response or its behavior will change, or otherwise the information, some changes will happen to the information content. So these are also potential analysis classes. Then there are roles. Roles are instead of the people, we write roles. So there are things like manager, engineer, salesperson. So those are also one of the cues for the analysis class. Then we have organizational units. That is divisions, groups, teams, so and so forth, that are relevant to an application domain or problem. If they are relevant, we may be having it, but not necessary that we include it. But when you read the statement of the problem, if these kind of terms come up, then we can take them as a potential candidate for the analysis class. Then there are places like we may have something like a production floor, store, or work site, things like that might be described in the requirements of this problem statement. So those things also are candidates for the analysis. And structures, some of the structures such as vehicles, sensors, computers, they cannot be called as objects because objects are simpler, smaller level, and these are many objects are assembled to form a structure. So those kind of structures, if it used in the description of the system, then we can consider them for the potential class. So once we have determined the potential class, then we have to check whether they are actually to be selected or not. So everything that we put in the potential class list cannot be the final class. We may have to eliminate, we may have to change or something else. So some criteria has to be used to do that. So so there has been some criteria has been given by Code and Norton to eliminate, select or eliminate or merge the potential classes to form, come out with the final classes. So what are the criteria that we will have to look into? One is the retained information. That means potential class will be useful only if information about it will be required to be retained and used for the system function. So unless, if it is not a persistent kind of information, then we don't need to consider it as a class. Then next is needed services. Does the potential class have a set of identifiable operations that can change the value of its attribute? So if there is a service like that, then we can take it as a potential class, or we can consider it as a criteria for moving it to the selected class. So then we have to go for multiple attributes. Any class which has multiple attributes is our focus. If a potential class has only single attribute or one or two attributes, then what it can be? It can be represented as attribute of some other class. So maybe we can merge it with another class. So multiple attributes are one of the criteria for moving a object or a class from the potential list to the selected list. Then common attributes should be able to assign a set of attributes to the potential class which are applied to all instances of the class. That means these set of attributes should be common over many instances of the class. If such kind of situation arises, then we can consider, because they are more stable and more we can store information about it, and we will be interested in such kind of potential classes which have common attributes. So what is attributes and what is operations? Attributes are the set of data objects that fully define the class within the context of the problem. So when we look at the context of the problem and we try to define data objects, then they will have some, when we try to define the classes, inside the classes, they, within that class definition, there will be some data objects which will define the class. And so those are called the attributes. And to develop attributes for a class, a software can study use case and select those things that reasonably belong to the class. So something, if certain elements are belonging to a class, so already class is identified, then those data elements or data objects can be called as attributes of the class. And similarly, there is a operations is included in the class description. Operations defines the behavior of the object. So we know that classes are instantiated by taking the object, and objects are generalized to classes. So many times we will use this term class and object interchangeably. So operations define the behavior of an object. There are four broad categories of operations. Operations that manipulate data, and operations that perform a computation, operations that inquire about the state of an object, and operations that monitor an object for occurrence of the controlling event. So if some controlling event is there, then you can use the monitoring type of operations. So there are different types of operations. Each one may define some behavior of the class or the object. To derive a set of operations, analysts will study a use case or narrative and select those operations that reasonably belong to a class. So basically, when we want to define a class properly, fully define it, we need to have both attributes as well as operations. So that is why it is important to know what kind of things we have to focus to see that we get the proper definition of the attributes and proper definition of the operations of any particular class. Using the grammatical analysis, the verbs associated with the potential classes can be examined for checking the operations, because they are kind of doing things. Operations are doing some task. So they are either manipulating the data or performing computation or inquiring something like that. So because they are all doing action kind of things, so here we have to look at the verbs, and from the verbs we can identify the operations. Now we come to the next technique for identifying the analysis classes. This is called class responsibility collaborator modeling, or in short CRC. A CRC model is a collection of standard index cards. That each index card will represent classes. The cards are structured with three sections. Each card is having three sections. There is a top part and there is a bottom part, and the bottom part is divided between through the left and the right. I think some writing is missing here. Please read it as body of the card left and body of the card right. So here we have written it, list the class responsibility on the left. So there are two things that is to be written, that is responsibility and collaboration. So all the collaborators have to be written, all the responsibility of the class has to be written. So we take the body of the CRC card and we divide it into two parts, the left part and the right part. The left part will list all the responsibility, and in the right part we will list all the collaborators. So it gives a simple means of identifying and organizing the classes that are relevant to the system or the product, and normally created with all stakeholders. It may be an actual meeting, it may be actual cards, physical cards, or sometimes they are electronic or virtual. So what is responsibility? Responsibility is something that the class knows or does. It translates to attributes and operations. So we have seen what is responsibility, and what is collaboration or collaborator. Collaborators are other classes which are required to provide or receive information when an operation is being performed. So you have one class, its operation is being performed, then you need to interact with another class. So then it is called, the other class is called a collaborator. Class denotes the grouping of similar objects. Objects are instantiation of class. Collaboration represents a request from one object to another object for a fulfillment of its responsibility. So, for example, one object collaborate with another object if it needs to send some message or information to the other object to use its operation. So whenever one object will try to use another operation, another object's operation, then it will send a message or a information to that a particular object. So then we can say that there is a collaboration between two classes, because there are two classes involved. One object from the class 1, second object from the class 2. Then we have collaborations are identified by determining whether a class can fulfill each responsibility by itself. If it cannot, then it needs to interact with another class. So that way we try to see which are the collaborations. So what happens in the CRC modeling? Again, this picture I have taken from Roger Pressman book. So you can see the format. There is a class name and some description is there. And this is the body part, that is the header part or the top part. And the body part is divided into two sides. On left side is keeping the list of responsibility, and the right side is keeping the list of entities that with which or objects with which it will interact. So here is a four floor plan, and here is wall and camera. So let's look at collaboration and class relation. Three generic types of relations is examined to determine collaborator class. So whenever we have a collaboration, that we have understood that whenever there is a collaboration of one class with another class, in denoted in the bottom right part of the CRC card, then what we can expect is that there is some relation between it, between these two objects or these two classes. So, or whether all relations are similar or they are different. So we can find what are the different types of collaborations. The first one is part of or is a, defines part and aggregate classes. So if you have a relation, if you have something like chassis, doors, these are all parts of a car. So here it is a part of a relation or an aggregate kind of relation. Next is the has knowledge or has. It denotes an association by which information is shared. For example, here country and its capital city. Every country will have a capital city. So the word will have this has or have. So whenever we have these kind of words, then we know that there is between these two entities or these two classes, the city and the capital city and the country. These are the two classes. They have a relation which is known as a has a relation or has knowledge relation. And the third one is something which is not this and not this, that it is depends upon or it uses. This implies that two classes have relationship but cannot be categorized as the above two. Dependency could be of various nature. Example, a class will use an operation of another class. A class contains another class. So like that, we will have different ways of seeing the depends upon relationship. Another thing that we have to understand is that whenever CRC classes are instantiated, that means a new object is created, three types of classes need to be instantiated. So there are three types of classes. We can classify it according to the use. So here we did the RAS relation, and now we are classifying the classes. We are classifying the classes as entity classes, boundary classes, and controller classes. Entity classes are very easy to understand because they are related to the domain or the business in which that function has been defined. This is the same business environment in which the requirement has been given, and we are going to develop the software. So when the entity classes, they will represent some things that is to be stored in a database as persistent, or throughout the duration of the application, it will be with us. So if that happens, then you can say these are entity classes because they are basically data type kind of thing. These are subjects and objects if when you are doing the grammar parsing. So whenever you are doing grammatical parsing, then in the words, all subject and objects can be considered as potential entity class. And also main actors, any information or data flow, those things will also be part of the entity class. Then we have boundary classes. Boundary classes and controller classes are a little difficult to identify. They will be implied. So these are used to create interface. Boundary class is used to create interface. It designs, it is designed with the responsibility of managing the way entity objects will be represented to the users. So that means how it will be shown to him, how the display will be there, how it will be depicted on the screen. So those things, those kind of classes which will do that process in the implementation, those are called boundary classes. That means they define the boundary between two objects or two classes. Then we have a third category, which is called controller class. In the controller class, you have to, because there is a unit of work which has to be managed by someone, which is in the form of a service. So we have to design that. So we can think of a controller class, which is used to do this, to manage this unit of work from the time it has started to the finish. It creates or updates entity objects during that operation, and it represents it representation of boundary objects as they obtain information from entity objects. So whenever there is a boundary object which is getting the input data from the user, and it is passed on to the entity objects, that means they are basically getting information about the entity objects through the user interface. In that case, this part, this controlling this mechanism, will be the job of a controller class. Similarly, complex communications between sets of objects, then we will have to create a controller class. So now we come to assigning responsibility in CRC model. So we have seen that in CRC model, there will be one some of the lists of responsibility and lists of collaboration. So how do we assign this responsibility? So guideline for allocating responsibility to classes. System intelligence should be distributed across the classes to the best address, to best address the needs of the problem. And each responsibility should be stated as generally as possible, with a very high level of abstraction. Information and behavior related to it should reside within the same class, so that it will be more modular. The cohesion will be high and the coupling will be low. Information about one thing should be localized with single class, not distributed across multiple classes. And responsibility should be shared among the related classes whenever appropriate. So these are some of the guidelines for allocating the responsibility to the classes. So finally, after the CRC model, all these things are determined, then there will be a review. When all the participants in the review are given the subset of the CRC model, it's like playing the card. So there are a lot of CRC model cards, they are called index cards, they are kept. Then the set of participants who want to review it, they will come, and they will, each one will hold some of these cards, a part of the cards. Cards that collaborate should be separated, that is, no reviewer should have two cards that collaborate. And all use case scenarios should be organized into categories. So we will categorize the use cases in some way, some criteria, so that it is easier for us to manage the review process in the CRC. The review leader will read out the use case. As the review leader comes to a named object, a token is passed to the person holding the corresponding class index card. So he will read out those things, use cases, and then all the people should be listening, and they should be able to provide some kind of a, as the reviewer leader comes to a named object, so he should be holding that. So when he is holding that, a token will be passed to the person holding the corresponding class in the index. So all use cases will be categorized, and the leader will be reading it out. And whenever he comes to the name of a object, then a token will be passed. So these people are playing the card. The token will be passed to the person who is holding the corresponding class or the index card. The holder of the class will then describe the responsibility noted on his card. And the group will review it. They will debate on it. They will discuss it. And the responsibility, if it is satisfied to the user use case requirement or not. So the what is being done actually is that use case scenarios are being compared with the responsibility written on the particular class card. And if it is satisfied, then it is fine. Otherwise, if the responsibility or collaboration noted on the index cards cannot accommodate the use case, then some modifications are made to the card. This may include definition of new classes, corresponding CRC index card, or the specification of a new or revised responsibility or a collaboration with the existing card. So whenever something is missing in the index cards, in the CRC index cards, but it is available in the use case, so we have to accommodate the use case requirement. So therefore, we have to make modification to the card. So either you can create a new class, or you can create a new responsibility, or a collaboration will be added. So now we have completed the two methods that will identify the classes and how we can review it. Once we, in the first method, we move it from the potential class to the actual selected classes, and in the CRC method, we try to refine it by the review method. Now we come to the class diagram, and this class diagram normally follows the UML notation. So as we have said that there will be three elements to a class. There will be a name or the identifier, and there will be attributes, and there will be operations. So a class is a rectangle divided into three parts: class name, attribute, and operations. And there will be some modifiers that will be attached to either the attribute or the operation to denote the nature of the attribute or the operation. There will be some, if there is an abstract class, then it can be denoted as italics. Then we come to the class relationship in the notation of the UML. So there are different types of relationship: association, aggregation, composition, and generalization and inheritance. So association, a relationship between instances of two classes, where one class must know about the others to do the work. It is indicated by a straight line or an arrow. Either it will be a straight line without arrow, that means it is two-way, or a one-way, so that there will be an arrow. Example, client is communicating to a server. So there is an association, or there is a sharing of some information. Then there is an aggregation. Aggregation and association, where one class belongs to a collection and the other one is a part of it. So for example, instructor is a part of a faculty. It is indicated by an empty diamond on the side of the collection. Then we have composition. They are stronger form of aggregation. It is also a part of the aggregation, but here it exists with it. Without the whole, the part cannot exist. It has a lifetime control. The components cannot exist without the aggregate or the whole. So, and these are indicated by solid diamonds on the side of the collection. Then we have generalization or inheritance. And inheritance is a link indicating one superclass to the child class. So we have one class and a superclass relationship. So, or you can have a parent class and a child class relationship. Then you call it a inheritance. It is indicated by a triangle pointing to the superclass. So the child classes are generalized to the superclass. So these are the notations that we discussed. It's a part of the UML standard notations, and associations, aggregation, composition, generalization, realization, and dependency. Realization is the object instantiation. And we come to the association. There is an example here. The student enrolls in the course. General binary relationship. Also, it can be unary or ternary, commonly represented as direct or indirect reference, because here there is a two-way relation, so there is no arrow. So this arrow is incorrect. So we should not put an arrow, because that is a binary. May have an optional label consisting of a name and a direction drawn as a solid arrowhead with no tail, this small little thing, and it will have the name. And an arrow may be attached to the end of the path to indicate the navigation. So that is what I was telling, that which way it navigates, which direction the relationship navigates. Because it is omitted, it is both ways. And there can be multiplicity in associations. That is, in the link, we can write the multiplicity. The multiplicity will denote how many of these class are related to this class. So we can have this kind of notations, more than one, in more than zero instances. Or we can also have n is to m. And we can have a star where there is a, this is a wild card. So there is no limit on the number of instances. Then we can have one, it means exactly one instance, or this kind of thing, that means at least one instance. So here in this example, here there are six, or at least six, at least one. That means each faculty will take at least one course. And each course will be taken by one faculty. And here students, faculty are advising students. So students are advisee and faculty are advisor. So one faculty will do at least one student. So it is zero. It must do at least some students. Then there are some examples of the complex associations. This is binary in nature. This is unary in nature, and this is binary in nature. So you can have unary, binary, ternary, or any higher order. Higher order associations are very complicated to draw and implement, and also to understand, think about that. But binary associations are good to understand. So these three associations, ternary associations, will be very complicated. You can see an example here. This is a ternary association. We have a project, we have a language, and we have a programmer. So this can be instantiated by using a objects here. So this is the notation of objects. You will have a instantiation. This is P1 is an object of the class project, and we have to write a underline there. Similarly, C is the language. Language is the class, and C is a particular programming language. And Joe is one of the programmers. Again, there will be a different object, P2 project, and another language. So like that, you can understand. So normally, to understand ternary associations, it is very difficult, and it will be denoted by this diamond. So that is what we had written here. Division of ternary association into binary association may lose information. Only if such a case, we will try to do a ternary relation. Otherwise, we will try to make binary associations. And associations are represented by a diamond. Then we have another one that is called recursive association, when the same class is related to itself. So recursive relations can occur when there is an employee and a manager. So a manager is also an employee. So that's a very good example of a recursive relation. Then we come to aggregation and composition. Aggregation is a special form of association representing has a or part whole relationship. So distinguishes the whole aggregate class from its part or the component class. So we have an aggregate class and a component class. So no relationship is in the lifetime of the aggregate and the component can exist separately. So here the component can exist separately, aggregate can separately. This association is not a lifetime association. It's not a very mandatory kind of association. But when we come to composition, it is a similar kind of associations, but it is very strong because this component cannot exist without this composed item. So these are some of the examples. Here is a employee team, and here is the employee. So here are members. So here we are denoting this composition by giving a diamond, solid diamond. So we said here, in composition we will give a solid diamond, and in aggregate we will give a unfilled diamond. Whereas here aggregate is an association with collection member relationship. So here we are showing it as a hollow diamond. So this module is part of the crate, but this module can exist on its own and crate can exist on its own. And here we are seeing this is a module. A module is actually this type, and it is instantiated and it is doing the service of this one, which is defined in the, this operation is defined, this dot service, this service operation is actually defined in the module class. Similarly here, you can see new employee is instantiated, the new function is used. This is a part of the implementation. Here also part of the implementation. I'm giving it because it is easier to understand the relation. So everybody understands this kind of coding. So here, this is the employee. So new employee has been instantiated. So composition is aggregation with lifetime control. Owner controls the construction, the destruction. Part of object may belong to only one whole object. So whenever a team member is getting instantiated, he will become a new employee. So one new employee class is being created here. Then we have another example here. There is this part is composition, whereas this part is aggregate. So here it is, it can exist on its own, and it can also exist as a part of the whole. But here college cannot exist without the university, or a department cannot exist without the college. So this is another, and you can see the multiplicities are also depicted on these arrows. And we come to the next relation, the third one, last one, that is called the dependency. So in dependency, relationship between the entities such that the proper operation of one entity depends on the presence of the other entity, and changes in one entity would affect the other entity. So it is normally said, is denoted by use. That means one class will use the other class. When one class uses the other class, we said they have a dependency relationship. So there are so many generalization and specialization and one type of dependency relationship. Every attribute customer is also an attribute of its subclass. Subclasses are specialized superclasses. The common form of dependency is the use relation among classes. And this is the one example of inheritance, where you have a superclass and you have a child class. So that's also called as a base class and a derived class. And this is the class B extends. So coming to the end of the lesson, what we have learned today, we observed that class modeling is done as part of the requirements elaboration or analysis activity following the object-oriented approach. So when we are following the object-oriented approaches, then the class-based elements, we will have to do the class modeling. And we discussed two methods. One is the grammatical parsing method for identifying analysis classes and specifying its attributes and defining the operations. We then discussed the CRC modeling method and how to do the CRC review and finalize the class and its responsibilities and its collaborators. Then we have seen that there are three types of classes that we need to identify to completely specify our problem system. One will be the entity class, which is very easy to determine because it is related to the business and then we can have boundary classes and controller classes. Boundary classes are defining the interfacing between external entities and the system, and controller classes are taking care of the sequence of events. So we need a controller class. So to do the use case complete implementation or completely design it, we need these three types of classes. And we have also examined types of class relations and what is the convention of developing the class diagram using the UML notation. So we have completed the discussion on the class-based methods, and thank you very much. And in the subsequent lectures, we will see the behavior modeling, how to do the behavior modeling in the analysis modeling activities. So thank you all. We will meet again.